She was the 25th of 25 children. Yeah. Think about that. A trip to Costco was an all-day event. Woo! And they'd be the only family in line where the Costco portions would last them for one day instead of a month. That's the way it was, but we'll never really know because there wasn't a Costco around then. She was born in 1669 in England. And you'd think that being the 25th child might cause a little consternation or, you know, just it'd be a rough thing, you know. It'd be hard to recognize. You're like, who are you after 25? Think about it. How many do that after the third child? Raise your hand. Yeah, the 25th kid. But apparently she didn't seem to mind because when she got married, she had 19 kids. They celebrated family Christmases at the Royal Albert Hall. Big family. Actually, she ended up raising only 10 kids. If you know anything about the 1600s or even before, the infant death rate was high. And she lost 9 of the 19 kids to infant death. They were poor. They couldn't afford any medical care, and medical care wasn't that good anyway. But on top of that, her husband was put into prison, debtor's prison, twice. So he'd be gone for long periods of time. But she didn't complain. She wrote to her husband this. She said this: I am the mother of this large family, and though the superior charge of their souls lies upon you, I love that. That's the lady. She knows, because it does. Yet in your long absence, I cannot but look upon every soul you leave under my charge as a talent committed to me as a trust. I'm not a man nor a minister, yet as a wife and mother, I feel like I ought to do more than I have yet done. So I have resolved to take a portion of time that I could spare and discourse with each child alone. Whew. My question is, you have spare time? Time that you have to spare? Spare time? Apparently she did, though. She found some somewhere. She homeschooled every child, raising them with love and discipline, and giving them a good education. They were taught to cry softly, eat what was put in front of them, and not raise their voices or play noisily. And corporate punishment was used, but they can get out of that if they confess their sin in front of her. Good thing. And all but one of her children learned to read. I mean read, not just one or two words, by the age of 5. Yeah, but she didn't have to deal with cell phones. True. But her house burned down twice. And she held church at her own house every Sunday. About 200 people attended. And she did the preaching. And she wrote 3 Bible commentaries. And 2 of her children, John and Charlie, went on to start the largest Protestant denomination in the world. And between them, they wrote over 6,500 hymns and won tens of thousands of souls to Christ. Yeah, but she didn't have to deal with pronouns. Susanna Wesley was her name. She was an extraordinary woman. Get this, though. One of her children was asked one time, well, how does she do it? I mean, really, how does she, coming from a large family, she probably had brothers and sisters she had to deal with, and then, you know, 10 of her own kids. How did she do it? You know what the child's answer was? This is how mom does it. It's the rest that she gets. That's how she's able to do it. What? The rest that she gets? Because, yeah. She said every afternoon, mother would sit in her favorite chair and pull up her apron over her head. And that meant that the children could not bother mom at that time. And she got her rest at that time. And she would sing hymns, and she would pray, and she would read, but she would always rest. We're in a series called You in Two. Say it with me. You in Two. That's right. It's about being intentional, setting some goals. Where do you want to be in 2 years? Thought about that? We often don't. We're often not intentional about life. We're often just letting life happen. Or we set some kind of a personal enrichment goals, health goals, finance goals, job goals. But what about your relationship with God? What about your spiritual life? You ever thought about that? You ever thought about being intentional about that? Where do you want to be in 2 years? What about the transformation that God is doing in you? He does the transformation, but are you allowing that to flourish in your life? And if not, where do you want that to be in 2 years? The Apostle Paul put it this way in Romans 13:12. He said this, remove your dark deeds like dirty clothes and put on the shining armor of right living. Now, the power to do that is from God, but the choice to do that, that's yours and mine. Are you interested in becoming the person that God created you to be? That's what we're talking about in this series. Look out 2 years. Who do you want to be? Do you look at that and say, you know what? I need some shining armor over here. It's a little dirty. And here. And here. And here. And a couple weeks ago, we talked about what needs to happen in your life and in my life to start that process. And we said, you know what? You need to fill up. That's why this thing's on stage. You need to fill up. We said this. Prayer is the fuel that launches your life. Prayer is the fuel that launches your life. Prayer is about seeking God first. It's about aligning with God first before you get started. Then you can hit the accelerator. When you start on your knees, you can literally go everywhere. Amen? It's true. But last week we reminded ourselves, you know what? We can hit the accelerator, but we don't have to like take leaps and bounds toward these goals. We don't. We found out that a journey of 1,000 miles starts with a single step. That we just needed to win the day. Say that with me. Win the day. Win the day. One battle at a time. One day at a time. Taking what we call stupidly small steps that give us daily victories and start a momentum that's hard to stop. And if you want to hear about any of those sermons, either the prayer one or the win the day one, you can go on our website. It's mbcfamily.com, and you can either watch or listen to them. They're there. Today, you might think it's the third message in this series. You might think that I would come here and continue the momentum that we've started with some supercharged, turbo, surefire biblical principle that will launch you towards your goals. And that's exactly what I'm going to do, but it might not be in the way you think. Today I want to talk about an energizing, powerful force that is absolutely critical to you becoming the person God created you to be. And it's a force that's been around since the beginning of time. You may have guessed it by the story I told to start with. The principle is one word, rest. Rest. You'll hear it all through the Bible. And it started at the beginning. Rest. Say that with me. Rest. Man, you guys were so much more energized with that thing than you were the other principles, man. You like this rest thing. Amen? Amen. That's the energizing, supercharged, powerful force. Rest. And you might ask, well, what does rest have to do with accomplishing anything? Well, quite a lot, as Susanna Wesley found out. Raising all those kids, having that big family. But you've got to first understand what rest is. Sometimes we think of rest as sleep. And it can be, but not necessarily. Dr. Carolyn Leaf has spent the last 30 years studying the mind and the brain. And in her research, she discovered that chaotic and stressful and undisciplined and unmanaged thoughts, that we can take those into sleep and still sleep, but we don't get rest. Those thoughts are going all the time. And when we wake up, it feels like we've been in a 12-round bout. And we're anxious and we feel like we got no rest. How many people have experienced that before? Raise your hand. Yeah. We all have. And that's true. That's not rest. You feel like you're frazzled. So sleep can be rest, but not necessarily. Sometimes we think of rest as a lack of activity. And it can be. But it also can be this guy. I call him lazy. Laziness have rest, and rest have very little in common. While God commands us to rest, let me tell you what he says about being lazy. Proverbs 21:25 says this. I'm glad we got off of that picture. Oh, boy. The craving of a lazy man will be the death of him because his hands refuse to work. Proverbs 26, I love this one. 26:14. As the door turns on its hinges, so a sluggard turns on his bed. In other words, a sluggard, a lazy person, is tossing and turning and not resting. A sluggard sleeps but doesn't get rest. Why? Because their life is probably unraveling if they're lazy. Amen? It's true. True. So let me give you what I consider the biblical definition of rest. I've gone through there's not really one verse you can do, but there's tons of verses that talk about rest. And I just try to incorporate those and say, let's get one line to tell us what the Bible says about rest. And here it is. To rest is to cease from toil, body and mind, and receive God's refreshment and renewal. That's rest. That's biblical rest. To rest is to cease from toil, body and mind, and receive God's refreshment and renewal. So let's kind of break that apart. First, rest requires a pause. Cease requires a pause for your body and your mind. As we work, and work's a good thing, God created us as beings that work. We're made to work. But we get physically and mentally tired. We get exhausted. And our body needs to rest. There was a young mom, excuse me, in New York, and she wrote, she had three kids, and she was recently quoted in a New York Times about her life, and she said this. She said, today was an incredibly exhausting day. The washing machine broke down, my cell phone never stopped ringing, and the kids wouldn't stop fighting. I finally sat down next to my one-year-old in his high chair, laid my head down on his tray, and began to cry. Without a word, my son took the pacifier out of his mouth and stuck it in mine. How many of you have wished they've had a pacifier in their mouth at one time or another? Raise your hand. Yep. Our body gets tired. We get exhausted. But so does our mind. So does our mind. Life gets a bit much. And your mind, it's bombarded with decisions that you got to make. Questions that have to be answered. Puzzles that have to be solved. Yeah. Sometimes, and I know you know this one, even the thought of rest can be overwhelming. If your to-do list is long and somebody goes, man, you just got to rest. The last thing you go, no, man, that's just another thing I got to do. Rest itself becomes overwhelming because you're looking at all you got and oh my goodness. Terrible. There's just too much work piling up. Too much going on. The thought of pausing, it just doesn't seem doable. But I want you to hear this. This is from Psalm 127:2. Says this. It is senseless for you to rise early and stay up late, fearing that you will starve. For he grants rest to those he loves. And what this verse is saying is that God says, don't toil unnecessarily. Don't rise up early and get up late unnecessarily. Don't do that. Don't just keep throwing more things at yourself. God takes care of those he loves. He grants them rest. Don't miss that. Where does rest come from? God. It says he grants them rest. Rest is something we receive from God. He is the source. He is the author of rest. He created the day, the world in 6 days. On the seventh day, he rested. Not because he needed to, but because he knew we needed to. And I've told you this before, God always goes first. If it's something he wants to do, he always goes first. And he went first, even though he didn't need to. He wanted to be an example for us because he knew we needed rest. I want you to think about this. Adam and Eve were created on the sixth day. Their first day alive was the day of rest. Their first impression of God is that, whoa, rest is important. That's their first day. God says, this is the day I want to set aside. This is the day I want some peace. This is the day I want to have an extra time with you, an extra relationship with you. In other words, Adam and Eve realized instantly that rest was not an afterthought with God. It was a priority with God. It was the first thing they knew about God. A day of rest. He valued rest. He rested on the seventh day. And he said, boy, let's keep this rest thing going. Let's make it a routine. And he called it the Sabbath, which means rest. That's what Sabbath means. Some people think it means Saturday. No. It means rest. And his people rested one day out of seven. Then Jesus came along. Matthew 11, 28 says this. Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Rest. In other words, there's no difference, Father and Son. We find our rest in God. We find refreshment and renewal in God. Jesus, he just wanted to let us know that he was here to fulfill all the Old Testament laws because we couldn't do them ourselves. So he came to do that. And he came to tell us that our lives would change from adhering to rules to appreciating the rationale for those rules. Let me say that again. Jesus came and he fulfilled, didn't eliminate the Old Testament laws, but fulfilled them because we couldn't. And he did it so that we could not be people who had to adhere to rules, but to appreciate the rationale for those rules. In other words, the Sabbath no longer had to be observed on the seventh day. That'd be a rule. But the rationale behind the Sabbath, that we need rest, should be affirmed and applied. That's what Jesus said. He said it a different way in Colossians chapter 2. This is Apostle Paul. Colossians 2 says this, therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. It's in Christ that you get your rest. The reality of rest is found in Christ. And the whole idea of resting in Christ, if you think about it, requires a level of trust from us. Because we say that, you know, we hear that, we put it on, you know, coffees, mugs, and t-shirts and stuff, rest in Christ. What does that actually mean? Well, it's putting trust in Christ. It's putting trust in God. When you say, I'm going to rest in you, you mean, you know what, you've got control. You're telling God, I know you got control. I'm going to fully rest in you. I know, you know what, I can sleep and I can rest because you got things under control, because you'll take care of me. That's what it's saying. You know, sometimes we buy into our culture's narrative that the provisions that we get come from the work and the productivity that we do. That's what our culture wants to tell us. But when we rest in God, we're saying that we trust in God to provide for those things. Amen? Do you? Or do you trust in yourself? And that's why you can't rest. And that's why you're busy all the time. Because you really don't trust in God that he'll provide. And God said, rest in me. I will provide. You will have what you need. The people I love, my sons and daughters, they will get rest. He will grant you rest. Resting in God places our life in the rightful hand of God. Rest, rest, rest. You hear it all over the scripture. You really do. It's over 500 times in the scripture God talks about rest. That's more than prayer. That's more than worship. This thing's pretty important to God. We don't talk about it enough. Because we do put it in other, we kind of put it in laziness mode or sleep mode. And it's not just those, it's definitely not laziness, and it's not just sleep. Psalm 116:7 says this, return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. Aesop, who was probably heard of Aesop's Fables. He was a Greek storyteller. And he once challenged a man who never thought he needed rest, never rested, never relaxed. And he picked up his bow and arrow, and he kind of put the arrows aside, and he picked up his bow, and he loosened the string of the bow. The guy's looking at him, and he said this, "Answer me this. What does the slack in the bow imply?" And the bow had slacked, and it actually fanned out a little more, because that's what it does when the string is relaxed. And he says, "What does that imply?" And the man looked at it for several moments, and he had no idea the point that was trying to be made. So Aesop explained, "If you always keep a bow bent, it will eventually break. But if you let it rest, it'll be there when you need to use it. And it'll be more fit when you need to use it." God knows that we're more fit in life when we get rest, when we're not tight all the time. Which is one of the reasons God has us confess our sins. Did you know that? When you have unconfessed sin, one of the things about unconfessed sin is it plays unbelievable tricks with your mind. You cannot put your mind at rest when you have unconfessed sin. And God lets us come before him and confess our sins and come before each other and confess our sins. And what does he give us? Forgiveness. And forgiveness is a sort of rest. It rests the mind. We are forgiven. Our mind can be at rest. It's another way God gives us rest, through forgiveness. And God is very specific about rest. In fact, he even lets us know the best time to rest. And you see this all over Scripture. It's the time from evening to morning. Say that with me. From evening to morning. It's a period that if used properly, it'll bring a dramatic change to your life. Evening to morning. It pops up all over Scripture, starting right from Genesis 1. God creates the world, each part of the world, and we find these words after he created some part of the world. He creates some part of the world, and then it says at the end of that verse, it says, "And then there was evening, and then there was morning, the first day." And then God goes out and creates some other part of the world, and it says, "And then there was evening, and then there was morning, the second day." And then he creates something else, "And then there was evening, and then there was morning, the..." You got it. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. From evening to morning. In other words, the days are marked off only when evening to morning is complete. Then the day can be marked off. The day was not marked off until that last line. God said, "Then there was evening, then there was morning." That's when the day is complete. In Genesis chapter 3, Adam and Eve were blessed with the presence of God. When? Well, Genesis 3:8 tells us. "Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day." In other words, the presence of God is uniquely experienced here by Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. When is the cool of the day? From evening to morning. That's the cool of the day. In the book of Exodus, God gave provisions to his children who were walking in the wilderness. You remember that story if you've been in church for any length of time. And the Israelites are walking in the wilderness, and God miraculously gives them provision. He feeds them. Some of you know this. He sent down Krispy Kreme donuts. Back then, they called them manna. But listen to how the Bible says. The Bible says they were sweet bread that tasted like honey. Is that not Krispy Kreme donuts? In Exodus 16:8 says this. Moses said, "You will know it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning." In other words, God's provisions came evening to morning. God's presence, God's provisions, and then God gives Moses the Ten Commandments, God's principles for life. And he tells Moses to make sure every family passes them on to their children. And he goes and he takes Israel aside and he says, at a specific time of day. And he says this in Deuteronomy chapter 6. He says, these commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home. Gee, when is that? From evening to morning. Talk about them when you walk alongside the road. You know when Jewish families walked alongside the road? When they took their kids to school before they went to work. When you lie down, that's the evening. When you get up, that's the morning. From evening to morning. The time to pass on the principles of God. So let's review. Time for the presence of God, evening to morning. Time for the provisions of God, evening to morning. Time for the principles of God, evening to morning. And a day will not be complete without it. Why am I even talking about that? We're talking about rest. How do you venture into from evening to morning? Well, God brings that as a specific time. It's not the only time, but it's a specific time that we need to think about. Match that. Go back to our definition of rest. We say, to rest is to cease from toil, body and mind, and receive God's refreshment and renewal. Being in God's presence, receiving his provision, and learning his life-giving principles. That's the essence of refreshment and renewal. That's true rest. And God says, make sure you make a priority this time of the day. Because we often forget that time. We make goals and we often try to fit it from 9 to 5, don't we? It's like, well, that's when we do everything. We got so much else to do during that time, and we want to fit everything else in there. So now we got these UN2 goals. Okay, let's fit them in there. Do them at lunchtime. Do them somebody at work, whatever. And we forget about this beautiful time that God gave us from evening to morning, a great period to find true rest, a great period to win the day. Move toward your you and two goals. Become the person God created you to be. Don't neglect that period of time. If at all possible, keep that time from being interrupted. In other words, have it uninterrupted time. You know this 24/7 thing that we're living right now? Life wasn't always that way. We live in a 24/7 society, and it wasn't all. In fact, fairly recently, just a few hundred years, that we've been living with this 24/7 philosophy. Before 1879, people settled in for the night when evening came, and they ate together as a family. They read books together, and they read the Bible together as a family, and they slept longer. They slept better and rested better because in many of the homes, the last thing before sleep wasn't the anxiety of a to-do list, but many homes read the Word, the refreshing Word of God, before they laid their head on the pillow. And that's what they had to think about so that they get a restful sleep because God's going to grant them that rest. Instead of, oh, gee, I got to do this tomorrow, I got to do this tomorrow, I got to do this tomorrow. They put that aside. When the evening came, they gathered as a family and put that aside and read God's word and were refreshed and renewed and could sleep and rest while they were sleeping. So you say, well, Pastor, what happened in 1879? Well, Thomas Edison happened in 1879. He invented the incandescent light bulb. And the race was on. The race to see how much work we could fit into a day and a week. When Edison flipped the switch, the whole world discovered what could happen when there was unnatural light that could be commanded at the touch of a button. And off we went. And the work days got longer. The work weeks got longer. Before that time, we had candles and lanterns. Well, the poor people didn't because they couldn't afford the oil for the lanterns. But even then, both candles and lanterns were light that was very limited in what it would allow people to do. Today, we live in this world Anytime, anywhere, we're accessible. We're available. We've moved from Thomas Edison to Bill Gates to Steve Jobs, and we keep going with our technology that severely challenges our ability to rest, which is why we need to find ways to be inaccessible. Amen? Try being in airplane mode for a little while. Just click something off. I do this. Many of you have texted me at a time where my phone's off. There are times each week where my phone is off. My email, I don't look at email, I don't look at text, I don't care. And I hear all the excuses. I know that, you know, people go, I can't turn my phone off because what if there's an emergency, you know? I wonder, I often wonder this. How could we have possibly stayed alive before cell phones? How could it happen? How could we communicate before TikTok? Really? Before Twitter? How could we even talk and relate to each other? It's amazing to me that it happened. Oh. Did you know that we won a revolutionary war before Twitter and TikTok? We did. And we had to communicate. There's actually a letter that I have read from George Washington. Do you know how they communicated back then? George Washington's in battle. All the people are ready. He wants to advance on New York. Do you know what he had to do? Couldn't phone, no cell phone. You know what he had to do? He wrote a letter, gave it to a messenger. The messenger went to the Continental Congress. They had to approve that he wanted to advance. Send the messenger back, he gets it, and then they advanced. And they won the battle. And they took New York. It's amazing that we can communicate that well. Did you know that we put a man on the moon before Snapchat? It's amazing. Before email. Now I have fun, and my point today is not to rail against technology. I like technology. I carry my phone around. I like the fact that it's good. I can put all kinds of music on my phone. That's great. That's not my point. My point is that we got to make a choice when we do have this technology to have maybe a sundown on that technology. Talking about being intentional again. This whole series is about being intentional. Do you intentionally have a sundown for your technology? If you're not, you should. And not just for your kids. I know a lot of us have that. Our kids can't have this. What about you? Do you have a sundown for your technology? You should. It's hard to get rest. It's hard to have undistracted time when you got that thing going off or you're waiting for the next call. Doesn't work. And we neglect this time from evening to morning to get our minds at rest, true rest, biblical rest, to get our minds undistracted so that we can be with our family, be with our God, and sleep. Let me just say a word here about sleep. You need sleep. That's it. That's my word. I mean, look at your pets, really. They do a great job getting sleep, don't they? We can learn from our pets, our dog. They do a great job. Man, think of a puppy after he sleeps and then it's got all kinds of energy, right? I want you all to be puppies. Sleep. If you really want to participate in God's great adventure for what he's got for you, you have to have rest. He built us that way. If you think you can do all this and just keep going, 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 you're wrong. You're going to hit bottom. You're going to hit a wall. It's the way God created you. He says rest. Over 500 times, rest, rest, rest. And there, as far as sleep, there have been extensive study that conclusively linked lack of sleep to irritability, to anger, to looking a mess, to depression, to reduced reflexibility, susceptibility to sickness, mental exhaustion. There's a big long list here. The importance of sleep in your life cannot be overemphasized. Psalm 3:5 says this, I lie down and sleep, and then I wake again. Because the Lord sustains me. Again, where's the trust? In the Lord. In the Lord. Not in how much you can work during a week or a day. The Lord. And sleep is certainly one of my U and two goals. Fess up. This is not an area I excel in. And those of you know who've gotten an email from me at 3:30 in the morning. But it is one of my U2 goals, because I believe it's keeping me from an even greater and vibrant relationship with my Lord, is my lack of sleep. And so for me, this is a biggie over these next 2 years, to get this down, to have biblical rest, which includes good sleep, not hurried sleep, not oh, gee, I got to do this tomorrow sleep, but going to sleep knowing that I'm going to rest in Christ. I'm going to think about his words when I go to sleep, what he's doing in my life. I need that, what you call full retreat from the craziness of the day. And I say that because I found an article. I've never been in the military, but I found an article about what the military now calls strategic retreat. Because I always think of a retreat as a negative word. And I need to retreat from the day. And then I think, oh, gee, that's like, you know, those old people that say check out, you know, take drugs or whatever. Like, I don't like it. It just seems negative to me. But the military, there's times when they retreat when they've lost a battle. But then there's times that they retreat when it's a strategic retreat. It's a maneuver. They haven't lost the battle. It might be because they're luring the enemy to a place where they can't defend themselves. It might be because they're luring the enemy here in the center and then flanking them on the sides. There's lots of reasons to retreat that not because I've lost a battle. And they call that time, that kind of retreat, strategic withdrawal. And I love that phrase. Because let me tell you, there's a lot of times I'd like to strategically withdraw from my duties. How many people would like a strategic withdrawal? It's true. We would. It doesn't mean you because you've lost a battle. A lot of times they strategically withdraw so they can get a better picture of the whole thing. A better, it's more proportional. They say, okay, I see what's going on now in the whole battle. And sometimes that's what we need to do. Strategically withdraw. Get some rest. And then all of a sudden, the things in our life take on a new perspective. Listen to these words. Take advantage of rest. For when you come back to work, your work, your judgment will be sure. Remaining constantly at work causes you to lose judgment. Put some distance between you and your work, because your work will appear smaller. In other words, got perspective. And then the whole of it can be taken in. And any lack of harmony will be readily seen. Who said these words? Well, they were said a long time ago by a guy named Leonardo da Vinci. Da Vinci was not a slothful man. And he thought rest was really important. Da Vinci was a painter, a sculptor, a poet, an architect, an engineer, a city planner, a scientist, an inventor, a military genius and strategist, and a philosopher. And he thought rest was really important. You had to take a step back, not just in looking at your painting, but in everything you do, take a step back. Get some rest. Here's the thing. God chooses to meet us in a space where we've said, this is my space where I'm not going to be distracted. When we get a space that we're not going to, that we take all the distractions and get them out, God chooses to meet us there. That's powerful. That means that's where you want to go. Because God said, man, I'm not going to be where you're all distracted and stuff like that. But when you take a step back, when you get biblically get some rest, God will choose to meet you there. In other words, your rest then becomes a form of worship because you're communing with God. And it doesn't mean you have to be inactive. A lot of people think, well, rest, what you're saying, Pastor Drew, is rest just, you know, got to get everything around him, just sit here and do nothing? No. Rest can be, you can do things in rest. Bible talks about that too. My mom's most restful place was doing the dishes. Some of you are going, you're a crazy family. Well, it's not genetic, I'll tell you that right now. That ain't mine. My mom never, ever used the dishwasher. In fact, we never had one. Didn't get a dishwasher. My mom liked washing the dishes by hand. That was her most restful activity. She loved the warm water on her hands. She loved to sit there, and she'd always either be praying or singing a hymn while she was washing the dishes. And that's where she got her rest. You think, that's not a restful activity. It was for her. God makes each of us differently. For my mom, that was it. And she let go of all her stress when she was doing the dishes. Which is why I usually would say to mom, hey, mom, you look stressed today, so I threw my dishes over in the sink. Because I'm such a good son. You can do my dishes. Thank you, mom. I want you to de-stress, so that's why I do that. But rest has many faces based on how God wired you up. Reading, listening to music, bike riding, some of you, walking, some of you, running. Some of you think, that's not a rest activity. For some of you, it is. For some of you say, the endorphins, and I don't run, so I don't know this whole thing real well. But, you know, you get in, it's like you get to a place where, man, and you can pray, and that's where you get your rest. It looks differently. Rest doesn't have to be boring. Have you ever noticed how you feel after you've really laughed? Laughing is a sort of rest. Because you feel that kind of contentment, that kind of peace that comes after you have a good laugh. Do something that makes you laugh. And you can have biblical rest where all the distractions are taken away. Because that's where you want to be. Someone once said this, and this is about music. If you've ever played an instrument or read a piece of music, you know that in music, in every piece of music, there's rest. Someone once said this: God writes the music of our lives. And as with any great piece of music, there are rests. We must learn the tune and not be dismayed with the rests. They're not to be slurred over, not to be quickly passed by, not to be omitted. If so, it destroys the melody. If we say, but there is no music in a rest, let us not forget that the song has a distinct and wonderful rhythm because of the rest. What I hope for you is that, especially in this U and two, if you haven't before, you'll start applying rest to your life. And God bless you if you're already there, because you need it. We all do. I want that so much to see that wonderful rhythm of music that you individually can make because of the rest. That wonderful rhythm that we can make as a church because of the rest that we take as a church. We've even talked about this as a staff to say, man, we don't want to have just a bunch of activities that everybody thinks they have to go to. Churches do that sometimes. They want you to rest, and then we just pile on the activities. Here, do this, do this, do this. We got to make sure, as a church, we give you time to rest. So that's my encouragement for you today. Go home and rest. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, I just thank you so much for your admonition on rest, Lord, that you say it so much. Lord, I'm not even sure we know. Lord, even after preaching this, I'm not even sure I know all there is to rest. But I want to know. I think we all want to know. Lord, we want to have biblical rest. We want to rest in you, unlike we ever have before. And we live in a society and a thing that just keeps going, 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 going. And there's just something clicking all the time. Lord, help us be people that just hear that still, small voice that's going to come when all the distractions are away. Help us put those distractions aside so that we can hear you, Lord. And listen and get refreshment, rejuvenation, and renewal that only comes from you. That's our prayer for our church and for us individually. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.